And you could feel all the tension building up at the convention as the hustlers began to arrive. Must have been 9,000 or more that came through the door. The time was 11:55.
There were pickpockets and dope peddlers, murderers and thieves, card sharp gamblers with aces up their sleeves, bank robbers, burglars, boosters and pimps, prostitutes, call girls and all kinds of nymphs, loan sharks, swindlers, counterfeiters and fences, crooked politicians spending campaign expenses, hijackers, arsonists, bookies and the mob, and anybody else who ever killed, cheated or robbed.
Ex-Pugline Brown proceeded to pat us down while his broad checked our hats. Britton nodded to him slightly, and Brown shook us down lightly, treating us like diplomats. Brown let us slide, so we went inside with our 38 strapped to our chests. Without making a sound, we slowly looked around the scope and all the rest of the guests.
Ham Hock's hall was big, so there was a whole lot to dig. As our eyes swiftly scanned the place, the decor was fine. Everybody looked high as I focused on a familiar face. It was Stingy Brim Slim and his crime partner Jim, two hustlers from a long ways back. They were dressed to the bone, and their reputations are well known as bagmen on kilos of smack. They were rapping with Big Bill Wheeler, international dope dealer, about who was gonna win the night. Bill had bet a grand on a hustler named Van, who supposedly had his shit up tight. But me and Spoon, we just grinned as we continued to pin to see who else was there. We spotted Finger Poppin' Teddy and his call girl Betty, whose perfume had lit up the air. I recall the past and how Teddy's rep had spread fast for being so swift with his hands. From the wallet in your pocket to a ring watcher locket, we specialize in expensive brands. Now Betty, it was said, could kill a great boy in bed and make the chumps submit. They would come before they came, then she would pickpocket the lame while telling him that he wasn't shit. My eyes caught a glimpse of two super fly pimps who had just come through the door. I could tell they were down from out of town just by the clothes that they wore. Like a peacock's parade, they strutted around on silk slacks, handmade, sporting tan alligator shoes, decked out in colorful shirts of pink, yellow, and red, stitching a gold blue thread and acting like they couldn't lose. Spoon and I were impressed by the way these cats were dressed and how smooth they seemed to be. But there was one thing we knew for sure, and that's that there couldn't be no draw between us masters of streetology. We didn't find out till later from a booster named Ada the monikers that these cats went by. They were known as Spongy Carp from out of Harlem, New York, and his partner Chicago Shy. By now, champagne was flowing, the big band was blowing, as the musicians gave it all they had. Some cats were dancing, others were romancing, but everybody's head was bad. The joint was packed back to back, and the hustlers were eager to begin. They were ready to play from night to day, cause all of them wanted to win. There were private rooms in the rear at the top of the stair for the studs who wanted to lay, but the main set was below for the cats with the dough, the hustlers who had came there to play. We were now ready to oppose our illustrious foes, so we made it downstairs to the set. It was a quarter after one, and the players had already begun bidding on their opening bet.